to Means and Methods, a series of interviews with faculty at the College of St. Benedict and St. John's University, where we talk about ways that faculty construct new knowledge. With me today is Dr. Emily Kuffner from our Hispanic Studies Department, talking about her research. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Kuffner.
My pleasure.
Tell us about what you're working on or what you've been researching.
I am a scholar of Spanish literature. I study the literature of what's called the Golden Age of Spain, which is 16th and 17th century Spain. So I work on literature from that period. And I just wrote a book about prostitution in the Golden Age of Spain. So this was a time when prostitution was legal, but in brothels. So you had what was called municipal brothels, brothels that were run by the state. And they were usually outside of the city. Going back to St. Augustine, a lot of figures would defend it as being something that kept society running. It was something that kept society orderly. Until 1623, when the king, Philip IV, closed all the brothels in Spain. So you had this big cultural shift between this period where brothels were legal to this new age, and part of that was to do with the Counter-Reformation, the Protestant Reformation, and the Catholic Church's response of not wanting to seem to be defending prostitution. And so you had this radical shift in how people were thinking about prostitution that led up to 1623 closure of the brothels. I'm also bringing in a lot of historical research that's been done recently, and also reading those sorts of historical texts. So reading the sermons that preachers denouncing prostitution and supporting prostitution wrote. And also there was a woman who wrote a book to the king. She wrote a letter to the king. She wanted to establish a prison for women, for prostitutes. So I also read her book and how she was talking about prostitutes. So rather than just looking at novels and just looking at books as a cultural form, I wanted to look at all the cultural forms and how they were interacting with each other. And so I was reading both these historical things and the novels and other forms of literature, short stories, plays, etc., and putting all those things together. And when you look at it closely, that narrative is much more complex. Prostitutes often did go on to marry. Sometimes they earned a dowry by prostitution and then got married. Sometimes when they would go to these reform the convents for reform prostitutes, they would receive a dowry from the Jesuits or others, and then they would go on to marry. So it's not as though women didn't move between these categories. Sometimes women would have a family, and then later in life they would enter the convent. Sometimes they would leave the convent and enter other sectors of life. So it's a much more complex narrative than that sort of easy answer of looking only at sort of the dominant way of looking at society.
What's the most surprising thing you've encountered as you've been digging into these questions of women's experience in the Golden Age of Spain?
When you look at these texts, you find so many surprising things in them. So the fact that, for example, María de Sayas, a female author, was able to write in that time period and be accepted as an author. Her works were very famous. They were bestsellers. And then her works dropped out of the record because they weren't read by later generations. They wrote her off, oh, she's just a woman. We want to look at, you know, the real literature, which was written by men. When we think about what literature is, we have to think about not just who is writing, but who's writing do we value, and who are we reading? And so for a while, and often still today, women's literature is only read in women authors of such and such period. And so one of the things I always try to do with my classes is to put those things into regular classes. So whenever I teach a class on Golden Age Spain, I include minorities and women in the readings as a matter of course, rather than teaching women authors as a separate category. So I originally started taking Spanish classes in middle school, and then I went to Honduras on a mission trip when I was quite young, and I just wanted to know more. I wanted to be able to speak to more people and to communicate, and it was interesting to me to see how other people saw the world. And so I continued taking Spanish, and then I was an exchange student in Spain, and I lived in this town where there was an old castle from the medieval period above the town, and I used to just go there and think about, you know, what... who were the people who lived in this castle when it was the Middle Ages? What were they like? You know, what did they think about? And I just became fascinated by history and by the people that history forgot. You know, what was the daily life of peasants and slaves, for example? Because so much of history is shaped by the nobility, the kings, the princes, the wars that were being fought. Well, I think when people think about Hispanic studies, often they just think about language. And what we do in Hispanic studies is about so much more than teaching people how to speak Spanish, how to say silla instead of chair. We also study culture. We study history. We study linguistics, which is the study of how languages are formed. So there's a lot of interdisciplinary and very complex work that gets comes under that heading of Hispanic studies.
Are you an early bird or a night owl?
I'm definitely not a night owl. I am an early bird kind of by force because my children have to get on the bus at 6:15 in the morning, and so I take a time early in the morning before emails start coming in and just work on scholarship first before I work on teaching and all the other millions of things I have to do in a day.
And working at home or working in your office here or someplace else?
Usually I work at home, and I'm very fortunate to live in this time when I can look at texts from the 16th century in the National Library of Spain on my computer, mm-hmm. on my sofa.
Do you prefer e-books or print books in your reading?
Oh, well, that's a complex question because yes. I prefer the feel of the book and, mm-hmm. and looking in and being able to flip back when you want to remember what came before. So I like the feel of reading a book. But the world of ebooks has really just, you know, opened the archives and the libraries to the world. So I'm very fortunate and very grateful to be able to look at those things that are held in libraries half a world away.
And when you're actually writing your manuscript, then paper and pencil or on your laptop?
No, it's okay. Yeah. Anytime I try to write by hand, I realize how seldom I do it, and my writing is totally illegible, so I'm definitely a word processor.
Okay, and the fuel for the journey is coffee or yes. water? Coffee.
Oh,
or
coffee. Yes.
What do you read for fun?
Oh, well, I happen to think 16th century texts are pretty fun.
That's what you do.
But I'm also very fond of modern Spanish novels.
Do you have one to recommend?
Lucia Echeverria.
Okay.
She's an author who came of age just after the Franco regime, so after the dictatorship in Spain that ended in 1976.
There's really lots of lively interest about a whole range of subjects in your department. So thank you for sharing your work with us today, Dr. Kuffner, and thank you for joining us. We'll have more of these conversations in the future, so let's learn more about how faculty do their work as scholars. Thank you.